talk way too much then.
Sure.
You don't have to talk.
I mean, I think,
we can just watch. Oh, well, and talk as well, because the draft is going on, so we're going to the draft.
Woo!
Misery, you can finish your thought?
Let's see what's going on here in the draft.
Yeah, how,
I think for Liquid, like, putting mind control on a suitable hero is really important.
What's that EG on the...
Yeah.
I don't think he has been playing that well, like, recently, mind control. Not sure about hero pool or what, but he hasn't been really comfortable with his heroes. Like, most of the heroes he's playing.
I think Liquid's lineup has looked... Lineups has looked pretty strong recently. I don't know, maybe they're making mistakes and stuff, but I think their lineups are looking good. Like the Phoenix Treant, Gyrocopter kind of things they ran, which they also played against us in scrims, is really strong and it's really hard to fight against. But this is definitely something else.
Boone was saying at that point that the stuff like the Phoenix was inspired by playing a lot of the pubs out here, seeing how effective it was against the popular Lone Druid. Do you think a lot of the Western teams who have been coming over have been kind of learning a couple of things from their pub play out here, like the Doom we saw and then the Phoenix support, of course?
Maybe the Doom. I think Phoenix support has also been run in Europe quite a lot in pubs, specifically by a few players who like spam Phoenix support. So ever since the Sunray got buffed, it's pretty much been a very interesting hero on support, because that spell just deals way too much damage and heals too much. So, and obviously, yeah, it's good against Lone Druid. That combo is, I think, specifically to counter Lone Druid, Treant, Phoenix.
Lone Druid's still in the pool as well.
Yeah, but I don't think VP really plays that hero too much.
Yeah, but more importantly, the difference was like the earlier series where they were up against EG. I feel like G wasn't really unleashed. He wasn't like doing a lot for his team because he wasn't allowed to on his heroes. At the Invoker game, he went for the use. He didn't do much. And the last game, he was on Zeus, so he really need to rely on his team. Like, I think for VP to be successful, his hero is really crucial. They need to, like you guys mentioned, pick the Spiritbreaker, help his lane more, like let him own his lane and he will be able to do much more. Like, we didn't see it from the last series against EG.
He's one of the players I feel like that plays best with a small advantage in lane. Like, he's really good at exploiting the fact that he gets up like half a level or a full level, or gets his bottle faster or something like that. So I could definitely see that being the case. If you want to go by standard Virtus Pro logic, this is when you probably pick the Oracle. It's really good against Enchantress for the burst damage, and they played it together with Death Prophet earlier today with actually great success in that game. Mm-hmm. I think that was also against Team Liquid, I believe, that game. So it must have been, because they lost to EG and they won with that. So.
I mean, they first picked G0 this time around, so probably means that they're at least gonna play around that hero a lot, and you kind of have to when you... That's Oracle. Kind of have to when you pick a Death Prophet, because he's a bit slow, and if he gets ganked a lot, he's kind of useless, and it's very nice hero to gank for mid lane, because the drain is very strong early game.
What do you make of the two bans of Virtus Pro, the Ursa and the Lycan? I mean, they did just not like animals? I mean,
it's just like what happened in the EG series, where when every time EG was on Dire, they just did something to abuse Roshan.
Yeah.
So they don't want that to happen again. Yeah.
Talking about lessons learned from previous series. Yeah. Tusk picked up by Team
it's
Liquid.
Very aggressive. Like, with the Tusk, they would want to put a lot of pressure on DP, because DP, once again, is a momentum-based hero.
They placed Tusk on Kuroki earlier today, but also on, of course, Jarex as well. Is there any indication that we know who's going to play that?
I think
because of the Ench, I think?
Yeah, 90% Jarex.
Yeah, Kuroki will play the Ench, and Jarex with Tusk.
I think this is going to be a safe lane profit by Liquid. I think we played against this lineup before, and they probably might...
Off-lane Enchantress?
I feel like they're gonna pick... No. It's support by Kuroki, and Jarex plays Tusk, and then they're gonna pick, like, some Racer or something like that mid. Maybe Beastmaster offlane. That's the lineup they had against
seems
us.
Crazy.
Yeah, I mean, and it works really well with Tusk, and they're gonna roam this Death Prophet a lot early game. And then this, like, they can basically be four heroes mid instantly, with Tusk and Enchantress being around there, and then Prophet TPing in as well. And that can create space for mind control. Playing like some kind of one of the greedier, yeah, and there's your replacement for Razor right there. It's pretty much the same hero, just a different color. And then you have, yeah, mind control on some greedier offlane. That also can become a pusher. I think it's gonna be Beastmaster if it doesn't get banned.
In the game that Liquid won from Virtus Pro, they were able to push down a tier 2 tower at already 10 minutes into the game. Is it looking like they could do that again with this kind of lineup?
Yeah, I think so. I mean, it depends. Like, I think the tower push will become faster if Prophet is offlane, just because then he will TP there when he's level 3 or something like that, and then they just start pushing. The Prophet is safe lane, I feel like, might be a bit different, because they're gonna play mid heavy and not so much on the safe lane.
Why do you think they banned Tide? Is that with this draw strat and with the lanes they're putting, does he look like a very good
because
choice?
Because VP needs a hero that can protect their Prophet as an offlane. Like Void, that's obviously the best. And the second that comes to mind is Tide. You need some AoE to protect her in the fights.
And they don't really do anything to Tide. And I think if they plan on running safe lane Prophet, Tide does not care. All right.
So it's offlane Prophet. So like you mentioned, the push will come faster on the safe lane.
Yeah.
And yeah, they don't really have much like deep push from the other heroes, except for their Prophet.
Yeah, they don't, but at the same time, they can push themselves. I think it's really hard to stop the... Like, what happened in our game against MVP, they just kind of pushed us, and we couldn't do anything. Like, we didn't even trade or anything, but... You can't really stop this push, because it comes so early, and it's very fast. Because Prophet just TP's in from the other side of the map, and there are four heroes.
Yeah, would it help if it's offlane that has some deep push like Shaker, or anything that can help?
It doesn't really do anything. Like, what is Shaker gonna do? He's gonna Fissure once, and then they're just gonna stone him.
Ooh!
Flame Phoenix.
So they have a good amount of teamfight with the Death Prophet ultimate. And, both teams have good amount of teamfight, actually, with the Gyro as well.
The downside for Team Liquid is they have like almost no lockdown.
No lockdown. I was gonna say also, doesn't it feel like almost a bit too much cooldown dependent as well, building around the egg, around the Death Prophet ulti a bit?
I think when you play Death Prophet, it's like inherited thing that you have to do. You have to play around the Death Prophet ulti.
Mm-hmm.
So I guess that's fine for them.
Just make the most out of it.
But like you guys mentioned, they don't really have much disable apart from the cask from Witch Doctor.
Oh, I was thinking for Secret as well. They only have the Snowball, I think. So there's like very little lockdown, which generally favors Phoenix quite a bit. It's a lot easier. You get more possibilities of playing. You don't have to be scared so much about your engaging.
So, Misery, you know the draft now. Yeah. Who's gonna win?
Could be a game that VP wins. It looks like they're kind of draft where there's a draw in there, and you don't really understand it. You don't really know why there's a draw. Like, not really, but they make it work somehow. I think, like, this Liquid draft is just, it looks really strong to me. And I think it's gonna be hard for VP to handle the pressure that it's gonna come from very early game. And I don't think VP can really gank this Viper or do anything to help the DP.
You can ask me anything about their emotions.
Yeah, so you think both teams will win?
Anything.
No, I think Liquid will win, okay. To make it short, yeah.
Well, let's find out if that is indeed the case. It is time to go to our first game of our last series, Capitalist and Blitz. Take it away.
Thank you, Sheever. Welcome, everybody, to the professional cast of Team Liquid versus Virtus Pro. And we are actually going to be starting out with a five-man smoke, so things are going to get a little dicey right away. Liquid, all of a sudden, boom, right on top of Will. They're going to be able to get the quick first blood without a doubt. Liquid starting this series off with a bang, want to be able to have an early advantage. But welcome to the game. As we figured, what better way to be able to have a nice professional cast, completely unbiased, by having the Liquid coach cast Team Liquid. How you doing, Blitz?
Did you say a professional cast? Does that mean, where's LD? I don't see him around.
They're saving LD for a more important match later on.
Okay.
Oh, Baron is going to be snagged by G just in time, but Mutomba Man is going to try and chase him down with this Rocket Barrage, keep him out of the mid lane as long as possible. But everything else should be relatively normal here. Mind Control was the one who picked up the Bounding Rune at bottom lane, so we're going to have a little bit of a disadvantage for Viper mid, but we got to talk about this draft and the way it addresses Death Prophet. Your boys, they went all in at addressing Death Prophet as much as possible, which they're going to need to, as it seems, as Fod is immediately being zoned out by G and FNG. Combo.
Yeah, and this is going to be a hard lane to begin with. Luckily, he was able to get the first blood, but this is a Death Prophet that already has a Spirit Siphon, and most importantly, she's got the Precision Aura. Death Prophet is already one of those mid heroes that is meant to dominate her lane, but you give her the draw aura on top of the help of FNG and things get even more difficult.
So you guys are able to rotate Tusk, Enchantress, Nature's Prophet, all to deal with this Death Prophet. Is there something about Death Prophet that is particularly threatening to Liquid?
I think it's just fighting in those precise fights is a little bit where we struggle, or Team Liquid does anyways. I don't know why I say we, I'm not playing this.
Oh yeah, definitely not.
But I think it's just one of those things where they have to be a little bit more comfortable against fighting against the teamfight potential, and Fada has to kind of be okay with losing his lane here, and that's something that he's traditionally struggled with.
Fada's very much so been that kind of like 1v1 player, and would you say that kind of shows in his mentality of the game, that he really, it really bugs him when he loses that matchup?
Oh, for sure, but, you know, he's sort of the lifeblood for me. If he has a good game, then normally Liquid's gonna roll.
Take a look at some of the other lanes. DK Phobos is off lane Phoenix. That's something I also want to get into, because we saw most of the big AoE controlling off lane heroes being banned away. The analyst has talked about both Faceless Void as well as Tidehunter that would banned out relatively early on. So Virtus Pro went ahead and picked up a Phoenix. We've seen plenty of support Phoenix, but I think off lane Phoenix is actually going to be able to work here.
I think so. It really just depends on whether or not he can. I don't know, he's got the drawer, but at the same time, he's still against a pretty strong dual lane that can harass him out, and he doesn't really have the best options to go to the jungle or anything, and Kuro's focusing a lot of his attention up here. Like, DK Phobos, when you play this Phoenix, you can't really rotate with it because its spells aren't that strong, and
right.
You can't really jungle with it, so it sort of has to lane. What I'd really like to see at some point is when G makes his rotations, I kind of expect them to swap lanes, but this mid lane, it's just so frustrating to play against.
Yeah, it's actually the Phoenix, I think they probably assumed that they would be able to kind of abuse the offlane Phoenix because of the fact that it's dealing with a melee support essentially, because Enchantress jungling a lot of the times. But you could see Liquid, they're not actually rotating the Enchantress mid that often. We saw Smoke earlier, but they didn't follow through with it. They've actually been spending a lot more time keeping the Phoenix back at the top lane, so despite the fact that it, you know, kind of looks like just a melee support that should be zoning the Phoenix out, the way Liquid is playing it is still keeping DK Phobos at level 2 by minute 3. This is a really bad sign for this offlaner.
Yeah, and MC's about to hit level 4 at this bottom lane, but still, I think, pains me to say, but I think VP is doing just fine. They haven't really lost the safe room like they should, because nobody from Liquid can really pressure that down, and Crow's running creeps at this top lane, but hasn't really been too successful with anything yet. Yeah. They're gonna get this nice D ward off though, at least.
That is gonna be able to help out his experience at the very least, but is this perhaps overcommitment? Liquid is shutting down the Phoenix, because as you said, Kuro just seemed to be rather underleveled.
Yeah, that's always the danger of playing this Enchantress, is sometimes you're going to over-rotate, get a little bit nervous, and feel like you have to be on the move, and you're going to fall behind and farm. I don't necessarily think that this is a hero that's meant to just pure lane or anything like that, but you've got to learn to find a little bit better of a balance, and it feels like this game, especially Kuro's having a little bit of trouble with that, because he's vacillating between trying to zone out this Phoenix, but Jerex is already kind of doing it.
Yeah. I like this build. Silent actually has a Quelling Blade on his Draw Ranger, but he's facing up against a Treant Protector. Both the harassment of the trees is some cause for a Quelling Blade and that extra bit of damage you get, but it's not much. Also cuts down the tree that is going to be encasing him from Sprout. So.
You know why I think he does this? Because when he was spent, he was so irritated.
So many issues.
Yeah, he's.
Then now it's just like, never again. G is going to be chased down the middle lane. They do have the Spirit Siphon, but they're bringing so many members of Team Liquid into this middle lane.
Oh,
that
this
G
is unbelievable.
Be dying here. Gets off a lot of damage, though, so maybe the supports can turn this around and get a kill on Jerex. The cap, it bounces back to him. The heal's coming into play. Oh, no. It's not going to be enough damage. Lil actually turns on Mind Control. Oh, what a fairy fire. He actually tries to kill Mind Control, but once again, he just seems to be a little too unlucky in this regard. Unfortunately, the Oracle Purifying Flames was not enough to finish off either the Tusk nor the Nature's Prophet. Despite that really strong Fairy Fire turnaround, they both end up healing up and surviving.
And you see the strength of the Nature's Prophet is that he's able to turn that fight to that 4v3.
Mm-hmm.
And even with the heavy rotations by VP, it doesn't matter because the Nature's Prophet has a fair amount of levels. His right-click damage is pretty high with the phase boosts, and this is what you need to do against Death Prophet. Later on into the game, once she starts rolling, Death Prophet, Oracle, how are you supposed to fight into that? It takes so much. Meanwhile, her ghosts are hitting you, difficult to gap close because she has the Yule Scepter.
She's double healing out of Spirit Siphon.
Exactly.
Oracle's ultimate.
You have to take advantage of her as much as you possibly can in the laning phase, and this is why the early committal to the Nature's Prophet.
But Virtus Pro, seeing that Team Liquid are focusing so much on mid, see an opportunity with both their supports back at base. They decide to smoke from there and head up to the top lane.
Oh, this is going to be a really good game.
Couple, man. Oh, he's going to be right from that tower too. He drops the ultimate. They may not have enough damage to kill him quickly. Nope, they do. FNG is going to be able to survive through that blast, and Virtus Pro execute the perfect gank that they needed.
Okay, here's the issue though. You just lost G mid, and this is something I want to talk about is, if you're a mid player and you know that your two supports can't help you out, this is always going to happen 10 times out of 10. You're going to get counter ganked, your mid's going to get counter ganked, so you just have to play safe. You play a little bit to the right, you hide yourself a little bit because from Liquid now knows that they're two heroes, so they're going to think that DP is free. One Nature's Prophet rotation is enough. Jerix is going to come along too and get the kill. As a mid player, you have to relax a little bit. I think that's G's one semi-issue. Sometimes he plays a lane a little bit too aggressively, and he wants to get too much out of it. But he has to understand, he's showing himself on the map, everybody's showing themselves on the map. He has to know he's a free target on the map.
Tumba Man, after his death, is actually going to rotate into the safe lane as well, as CB a common trend in these matches. They won't be able to catch out Silent. Silent is actually playing a lot more carefully, maybe like G should have earlier. G does pick up the Exorcism at level 6, so if they can get a successful gank on mid, perhaps they can actually turn that into a tower push. But for now, Vada is not being caught out.
Yeah, they're going to go for this bottom tower, but at the highest level, and these are two tier 1 teams, they're always going to know that this safe lane is the least safe place at a certain time in the map, and you want to take this as a dire to get control of the enemy jungle. At the same time, that was a really smart move by Silent. It seems like a basic one, but since both supports are sitting behind mid, you make sure that you don't give an opportunity for Liquid to just get a free pick off on you.
And VP also transitioned that with their four-man mid to be able to take the middle tower, which you could say is perhaps even more important than the Radiant side tire. Yes, it controls the jungle, but Dire side middle tier one is also a huge control over the Roshan pit.
Everybody here right now is, the Phoenix is level 6, so Liquid has to be a little bit careful. They're smoked up. This might not necessarily be a fight that they want to take, especially since Prophet also has her ultimate up, but VP is going to avoid this entirely, make their way up top. Really smart rotation by them, understanding that Liquid is playing the catch-up game right now.
Yeah, they completely disappear from the bottom half of the map, and if Liquid's trying to play catch-up, then why give them the opportunity to fight? Virtus Pro, go ahead and take the Dire safe lane tower, and Liquid will now be the one trying to pressure mid.
Still, a lot of control being gained right now by VP, and most importantly, this is not costing them anything cap. They're not losing the too much. They haven't used the Death Prophet ult or the Phoenix Egg, but it looks like they do want to contest for this mid tower. With though, they've got to be careful. They don't want to hard commit too much just for this mid tower, as the Oracle's going to TP in first.
They're going to try and go on Furo. At the same time, they are diving bottom lane. DK Phobos doesn't find anything in the mid, but they do manage to pick up the bottom lane Silent. That means Virtus Pro really need to be able to win this fight. A supernova is blown, and that egg is not going to be able to last. Bait Zedek was thrown down by Lil to try and help out, but ultimately wasn't enough. Now FNG and Lil are both going to be caught. Liquid winning both engagements, both at the mid as well as bottom lane, essentially wiping Virtus Pro.
That is so huge, and that's just VP getting a little bit too greedy. G thinks to himself, okay, the rest of my team is going to be able to win this engagement. Liquid can't really respond to this, but now look what this leads to. You just lost your mid tier 1 tower anyways. Now you're going to lose a bottom tier 2 tower at 9 minutes into the game, and you lose all 5 heroes. This is going to open up the map so much for Liquid. I assume Roshan is the next objective as soon as VP shows themselves on the map, and you just can't afford to do this if you're VP. You have to tighten up your play much more than this.
Can they actually Roshan though? They have certain things to be able to tank up Roshan, Enchantress as well as Treant, but they don't have any minus armor nor the greatest physical damage just yet.
I think it's okay. They've got a lot of range heroes to hit it, and like you said, they have a lot of different ways to tank it with the Treants and the Sigil, so it costs them almost nothing to fight it. And they know that VP's egg is down too. That's kind of the fighting item, or the fighting skill that they need. Like VP, if they have the egg up, they can fight. But right. If Liquid knows that it's down, then they have the opportunity to work around that pit.
Looks like Matumba Man is going to be picking up an early SNY. Is there any, what's the reason that we don't consider, say, Helmet Dominator in this kind of game?
I think he just wants to play fast-paced. And when you're playing against this type of lineup for VP, you want to be ready to fight and take it to them repeatedly. You don't want to just play like the slow ancient stacking game, but...
Don't give the Phoenix space to be able to breathe and pick up a hand of Midas. Don't let the Drone Ranger Lil! He managed to save himself from a lot of that magic damage, but it's still not enough. Matumba Man takes a kill, but that being said, many of Virtus Pro are here, and they're going to be able to run him down. That is a worthy trade there for Virtus Pro, but they had to use Exorcism for it. That is kind of slowed down Virtus Pro's opportunity to push. If they didn't have to use that, maybe it would have been fine for them to go from that to perhaps controlling maybe the bottom tower or something like that, but...
Yeah. Good counter rotation by VP, but I think Matsu's kicking himself because he had the TP up and the Witch Doctor led there's maybe you pop the wand and then immediately just try to TP, I think there's like a small chance that you get out because the ghosts take longer than that half second to swarm onto you. And it's not even like the DP popped it instantly. He had some time to react to that, but Liquid, that's a pretty bad death by them, but they've still got a lot of map control going on.
Pearl is rapidly building into drums, I'm presuming Dragonlance, and then Ags sometime after that.
Yeah, I think that's the general skill.
What about the what about the mech builds that we see on Nature's Prophets? Because we're seeing so much early fighting, isn't there... Wait, Fada has mech.
Yeah.
I'm like, wait a minute, Fada's in the game, of course Viper has a mech.
I didn't want to treat you like Toby, so I was going to let you figure that one out by
yourself. That's fine, I'll make myself look stupid and solve it, it's all good.
Sometimes, you know, with Toby, I'll let him just like go on these rants, and then I'll correct him at the end, but with you, I usually know, I was like, I'll let him figure this one out.
Yeah, we'll figure out he's being an idiot. G is going to be caught in the bottom lane. Oracle is there, and they have a Spirit Siphon, so G is actually going to be able to heal up out of this one. Oh, maybe not. Wow, I actually thought that was going to be enough, but apparently not.
Garrix is playing really dangerously in, but he's just going to TP out 100% okay.
Yeah, they really lack stuns on both sides of the table, which means that some of these teams can play rather aggressive and rely on TP outs.
Everybody right now from VP, they want to defend this top tier one. There's no way that they just want a solo Viper. Got no mobility to take this by himself. And DK Phobos though, doesn't have the best farm. Gonna go for that Midas build. And this is always the issue with Phoenix, I feel, as an offlaner, is that it works well. And I kind of understand the reasoning why they decided to take it. The Sunray is fantastic against the Enchantress, the Viper, and the Gyrocopter.
Yep.
And for a large part of the game, the Fire Spirits are also going to be strong against those heroes. Because if you look at Liquid's lineup, something that they lack, aside from the gyro, is Magic Burst. But the laning phase is going to be so awful, and his rotations are going to be rough.
I think there was an offlaner that was better suited than Phoenix, because it certainly is one of the auto pickups of this tournament.
Not really sure. Was Void of it? No, they banned
Void. Void and Tide were both banned away.
Yeah. It's rough.
It seemed like most of the control team fight heroes were out.
Yeah. And like we talked about, Liquid, because they have so much of the map open, and the reason why is two people show top, right? And there's absolutely no way for them to get here in time. Their bottom tier 1 and tier 2 are gone. It's going to be a free Roshan for Liquid is... they should really like them to just start taking tier 2 towers now. We've got the benefit of being able to play aggressively. Everybody BP though are waiting behind DK Phobos, hoping for some kind of rotation up here.
And this is going to be rough. He's only just now picking up his Midas, and level 2 Supernova is really where Phoenix becomes a lot more applicable in teamfights, but it looks like he's only going to have that level 1 Supernova, which is quite easily taken out. Even if you get the perfect Fire Spirits, everyone targets it once on Liquid, and the egg is dead. So it's going to be hard for him to actually get a successful explosion.
The max Fire Spirits, too. At a decent level.
So at this point, does that mean that Virtus Pro need to avoid fights between the Aegis and not having that level 2 Supernova?
I'm not sure. The issue I think with VP's lineup is that they've got this drill core, but she dies incredibly fast and she doesn't really have the best heroes to utilize her aura. Like, if you look at their lineup, yeah, you drafted these like 4 generic range heroes, but
just because they're ranged doesn't actually mean that they take advantage of the aura very well.
If you were going to go for that, you might as well just grab a Venge. And it's not like they won their lanes overwhelmingly enough to kind of justify that, but it's okay so far.
They have Yule Scepter on Death Prophet now. That's a pretty big upgrade, but I'm really loving this aggressive ward that was laid down by Tusk earlier. It is scouting so many of the rotations.
Yeah. VP right now, I think they're way back into the game. Most of it just relies on trying to get farm, split up the map a little bit for yourself. They still have such an incredibly strong combination in their Death Prophet plus Oracle. It's just right now, they can't get into fights. They pretty much have to concede these tier 2 towers until, like you said, they pick up some items. The Phoenix gets level 11. I completely agree with you. I feel like that's really crucial for him to start having some impact. But for now, you just have to concede these towers and understand that there's not much of a trade that's to be had.
BKB also feels like a necessity for the Drone Ranger. He had the Dragonlance now, but that can be broken apart for the BKB if they need to pick it up soon. Fortunately, G ends up going down to the bottom lane. A quick gank there from Liquid. Chantress and Furion rotating. They probably assumed that he was going to be okay at that bottom lane with Liquid so aggressively taking the tier 2 at top, but Fortunately, that's just not the case. Liquid seem to be outmaneuvering Virtus Pro every step of the way so far in this first game.
Yep. I know for this game especially, they were super motivated after they had lost the series against VP. They felt like that was... That's something, as a professional player, I think you always, like, regret. Like, well, we were up a game, we were doing okay in the second game.
Yeah.
And this is their chance for revenge. Radiant's middle tower is under mid-tier attack. 2 tower, though, again, it's gonna kind of be hard to defend. I'm not sure how VP approaches this fight, just because they don't have the best initiators, Cap. If you look at it, what do they really lead with? DK Phobos goes into the egg, but there's not an ability on the side of VP. Kind of follows it up, or makes it difficult for Liquid to stop hitting the egg. And normally you have a pairing with it, right? You've got Gyrocopter, which forces you back, or you've got the tree ults you in place. I remember there was a time period where EG, I can't remember if it was EG, some team was running like Medusa plus the Phoenix. I thought that was really cool too as a concept. It doesn't really feel like VP, their lineup just feels so disjointed.
There's a lineup I recently remember seeing, it was like Faceless Void, Medusa, and Phoenix, I think.
Yeah, that's pretty cool. Maybe it's a
little That
bit
might be a little
ulti-
overkill,
yeah.
But...
That's a little ulti-reliant.
There was something about the Eater to range throw, and there was like just no range carries left.
Yeah. And this is so nice, casting this game. I can just like aim Liquid and go with it. I already got the AOK and...
Viper completes the drums. We have a decent amount of gold on Matumba Man as well. He has his S and Y. You've taken all the tier 2s, but you've taken them so early that you can't actually consider going high ground just yet. It's simply too early. It's a good way to throw your lead. So what is the best way to be able to control the game from Liquid's point perspective?
You control the southern side of the map, and you force VP to play on your jungle and eventually catch them out. And
which is exactly what VP's doing right now. They know they can't be in the Radiant jungle, so they're pushing out top and farming some of the Dire jungle.
Yeah, it's kind of difficult right now. If you're VP, you just don't touch the bottom lane.
Yeah.
Like, time and time again, you've gone down there, and it's led to disaster. You have to concede that right now, while Liquid has this Aegis up, there's almost no chance that you're going to fight. But as soon as it's down, pretty sure that's going to be peace timing. Start getting aggressive around the map.
They found Jericho. Oh, nice snowball over the cliff into the neutral camp. Mind Control revealed that one for him nicely while he was farming. I like the way that Virtus.pro are trying to challenge, but Liquid have... gotten some really good control here. Like, they cut off the Dire side jungle, like Mind Control is farming up these two camps, so Radiant can't take that. They've got this kind of ward trying to block up the Ancients, which is going to be another way, right, where Virtus.pro are able to find some semblance of farm.
Yeah. And VP is doing this pretty well. Like, nobody's been picked off since then. The issue is that they lost too much control in the early game. They needed to win the laning phase a lot harder with the draw aura, and... they needed to not make that mistake. When they split up, they sent the DP bottom and they took that 4v3 mid, which I still am not like 100% sure how they lost. But because of that happening, they're stuck in this position, but I would like them to fight right now. I think this is VP's best shot. You can't just give up another Roshan, and you're losing too much control around the map, because now Liquid have taken back control of their own jungle, they've got control of the southern side of the map, they're farming in the lanes as they push.
And if you wait too much time, you're going to have a BKB on Gyrocopter, which all but ensures you win team fights. Like, it's going to have to be a really weird scenario that Gyro actually loses a fight with a 10-second BKB and SNY this early.
Yeah, exactly. I think VP might be waiting for the Roshan to actually come up, and that's really smart by them, because Phoenix on top of the... If you can get it, the egg on top of the hill,
right,
and maybe get a really good Witch Doctor cast off, that could be your avenue back into the game, but...
Gyrocopter is a pretty strong hero against those kind of... weird structure-esque teamfight abilities.
Yeah,
like
exactly.
Tombstone as well as the egg, and that you're able to pop flat cannon and target that while still dishing out damage to heroes. Good wraparound here from VP. They're going to be able to catch out Jerix immediately, and now Liquid, they're kind of trapped, but Matumba Man throws out that zoning ultimate. DK Bolt is trying to get in position here for an ultimate of some kind, throws it down now with the death ward on the side. Liquid, they're turning to fight. Supernova, they're trying to pop it as quick as possible, but G, it explodes, and G's ripping through them with the exorcism, and they're on top of everything. Liquid are still somehow surviving through some of this, but G is going to be healed right back up to full. He's underneath Mind Control, and he's going to be able to take him out too. That is the fight that Virtus.pro desperately needed to be able to get back in this game.
Yeah, that combination of the Oracle plus the Exorcism absolutely destroys Liquid. And that was so close by Liquid. If they're able to get the egg down, then it's pretty much just the DP that they have to crowd control up, and they can do that. DK Phobos, he's like holding his breath. He's just like, you know, stomping on the table. He's like, one more second.
But even then, I mean, I think if the egg dies, I think Liquid still lose that fight, though.
It would have just been the DP up against three. I think they can win that fight.
Mm.
It would have been... I mean, it really hurt them. They all got stunned. Like, they were burning to death, Cap. It was like 3 seconds of stun where they were all hitting the egg and it didn't lead to anything. That's so much. Plus, he got all the fire spirits off. And most importantly, the sun ray was healing the DP through the Oracle Ultimate so much.
Mm, yeah.
Oh, so well done by VP. The fact that they were able to win that fight is unbelievable to me.
The problem with the fight in general, I think, is just... it felt bad to me because they're going in, they're focusing so much on the supernova to begin with, which means Death Prophet is sitting there with the exorcism hitting on them, full spirit scythe is hitting them, which is another way that Death Prophet is just like guaranteed to heal back up to full once that Oracle Ultimate ends. It would just seem like almost an unwinnable scenario the way that Virtus Pro posed that fight.
They also lost Jerix in the very beginning, and I think his snowball was crucial. They need something to just go on low, force him back.
Yeah.
Or force them to just be a little bit more inefficient with the spell usage, but Lil is such a good Oracle player. All of these really annoying heroes, Lil seems to just excel at. Like, he's just the best at.
Yeah, we know him as this is
Arc Warden.
But yeah, like long time ago, but now he spams out Oracle, he spams out Arc Warden.
I love the guy. He's just got like the most mischievous grin every single time he does something.
Yeah, he really does.
Yeah, he's just so happy to ruin your day.
He is rather sadistic like that.
Yeah.
BKB is now complete for Mutomba Man, and that is something that was actually desperately missing for Liquid in that last fight. The Shivas, though, that is a big pickup for DK Phobos, and because he survived through that fight, look at his levels. Well, not too long ago, we were talking about how the Phoenix was struggling to get to level 11, and now he's actually pretty close to knocking on the door of level 16.
Yeah, when it comes to XP, it's actually VP that are in a really good position.
Mm-hmm.
Unfortunately for them, it's their two supports are super underleveled. They've got a level 8 and level 9 support, but Oracle's already got everything he needs. He's got the Aether Lens, he's got the Max Purifying Flames. Doesn't really benefit from too much. It's these three cores that have been propelling P this entire time through, and they can fight around that, honestly. Like, Liquid's net worth is a little bit more balanced out, but VP, like, core heroes are keeping up more than well enough. Like, G's got an Octarine core now completed. I think the only way that VP actually lose fights now is if kind of get inefficient with their spell usage.
Yeah. That's the thing about seems to be about the way that Virtus Pro play in like in these last couple of matches has been that target priority for the enemy team seems to be so utterly important. If you just like look at this fight from VP and you choose the wrong hero to go on, just disastrous. They will never be able to win a team fight against this sort of thing just because the way they kind of crafted this lineup.
Yeah, so much of that came down to as well the Fate's Edict that he was able to cast. He got it on Kuro, I believe, at the last second, stopping him from getting them one right click that they needed off.
Uh-huh.
So I guess in that regard, VP's lineup makes sense. Oracle plus the Phoenix plus the DP in some ways. I think my biggest question mark is the Stroll Ranger, but I haven't really seen her be too active in fights yet.
So is this going to be an early Scythe of Ice here for Mind Control? Maelstrom into Scythe?
Yeah, I think so.
He seems to be going quite the more mid to late game sustained right-clicking build. Why is that? Why not stay in Aghanim's in this kind of game?
I don't think Aghanim's is... Oh, hold on this. I'm almost certain Kuro's dead here.
Yeah, Kuro's gonna be silenced up from Death Ward. That is one of the best abilities they have. And that goes down, taking slowly but surely, just staying ahead of the Shivas ever so barely. And Kuro will be able to get back. And now max CPs from... Oh, god, the snowball! It actually hit all three! Jerix, what a player! He stops all these TPs. The supernova is gonna be blown. He has to get the Fate's Edict out, allowing the supernova to explode. No! Kuro gets the last hit just in time. He ran down Jerix, but that was just a support kill, and now he's got to turn and fight the rest of them. Meanwhile, the top lane is being taken by both Matu as well as Mind Control Silent. He's stuck inside the Sprout. He's taken out by Mutomba Man. Oh, this is disastrous for VP. One quick misplay, and the game is practically over.
No, G doesn't have a TP either.
He's got no way back to base. He's futilely trying to chase down Fada, but it means nothing. They're just going to kite him around. That's going to be a lane of Rags at top. Matu's going to back up, and he's going to kill G. He's going to join in on this fight. How you doing? Man, I cannot believe that went so badly for Virtus Pro.
They just miscoordinated so badly right there, Cap. Like, a communication broke down there. They decided to go out there just like, okay, this Nature's Prophet is pressuring us, we've got to get back. But then they just start open TPing, and Jarek seizes the moment right there, catches them, like, half of their team with a snowball.
Yeah, a three-stun snowball. That was beauty.
Yeah, Jarek's just saved the game for Liquid, because VP, even though it looked like they were down a pretty prodigious amount, it was all centered around the two supports. Crow was getting a lot, the Tusk was getting a lot, and if you look at the Witch Doctor and the Oracle's net worth, it's nothing. But their three cores were keeping up really well. Mm-hmm. The Death Prophet has a ton of farm. Same with the Phoenix, I don't even know how that guy came back in.
Look at Roshan! Poor guy, I don't think he hit Crow once! Between Untouchable and the Sigil from Tusk?
That's ridiculous.
Now he's got the Aghanim Scepter too, and... Yeah.
But wow. We were talking about how, in kind of in the draft, how Enchantress can be strong against Death Prophet in certain fashions. Yes, you're susceptible to the Ghost perhaps taking you down the Enchantress and useless in that regard, but you also are a glass cannon-style hero that can just lay single-target damage into the DP, hopefully able to pop him and prevent that exorcism from doing damage.
You've got to be so frustrated if you're VP in that situation right there, because... they worked so hard to get back into this game. They had that dream fight.
Oh, Silent. This is a bad pickoff. The Scythe of Ice, recently picked up by Mind Control, joins forces with Jarek.
They get a pickoff on a hero that does not have buyback. Liquid just took the Aegis.
I think Fada's
actually
dead, though.
In a really great position. The rest of Liquid, they're swarming in. Matu actually wants to be able to come in from behind. He's going to be able to lead with the missile onto Lil, follows it up with the ultimate, trying to force out that ult of Oracle. He already used it, though, on G, who's now going to turn and fight Fada as well as Mind Control. But they're just kiting him around. They're using the Sprout to make sure that G doesn't have any opportunity to chase down one hero. Nobody dies on the side of Liquid, as they shouldn't. As G's just gonna get bursted down by 5, and it's another wipe to the favor of Liquid.
Everybody from VP is gonna fight back, but
it's only two heroes that can actually buy back. I was gonna say support just because I'm seeing Phoenix support, but the offlaner and the support, Matu? Oh, his Aegis there, but this is gonna be the second lane of Rax Drone Rangers. Coming up in 5 seconds, but the DP's down for another 35. DP, they know they can't fight this one, so Liquid, hungry for revenge after losing the series earlier in the day. 2VP starts out the series strong with a game one win.
They're gonna be breathing a bit of a sigh of relief, but I think Liquid should be mixed feelings, because yes, they won, but they had one fight really sloppy, and I mm-hmm. think they're gonna kill themselves, but VP...
Well, let's not forget, Liquid also in the previous series had a very dismantling game number one against VP, and we all saw how that series turned.
Honestly, VP have just been... They've had to play so many games in a row, and their series against EG was draining, but...